Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshipper, lover of leaving, ours is no caravan of despair. Come, yet again, come, 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 whoever you are, wanderer, worshipper.
Your religious beliefs or lack of belief, you are welcome here.
No matter your age, sex, sexual orientation, or gender identity, you are welcome here.
No importa tu ciudadanía, tú estás bienvenido aquí.
No matter your citizenship, politics,
or relationship status.
No matter your physical characteristics or health, you are welcome here.
Whoever you are, wherever you are from,
you are welcome in this place.
Good morning and welcome to the online worship of the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Montgomery for June 20, 2021. I'd like to welcome you. So glad you could join us here this morning, and I'd like to wish you a happy Father's Day and a joyous Juneteenth. I want to welcome you into this hour of worship with words written by the incomparable Langston Hughes.
Let America be America again. Let it be the dream it used to be. Let it be the pioneer on the plain, seeking a home where he himself is free. America never was America to me. Let America be the dream the dreamers dreamed. Let it be that great, strong land of love, where never kings connive nor tyrants scheme, that any man be crushed by one above. It never was America to me. Oh, let my land be a land where liberty is crowned with no false patriotic wreath, but opportunity is real and life is free. Equality is in the air we breathe. There's never been equality for me, nor freedom in this homeland of the free. Say, who are you that mumbles in the dark? And who are you that draws your veil across the stars? I am the poor white, fooled and pushed apart. I am the Negro bearing slavery scars. I am the red man driven from the land. I am the immigrant clutching the hope I seek and finding only the same old stupid plan of dog eat dog, of mighty crush the weak. I am the young man full of strength and hope, tangled in that ancient, endless chain of profit, power, gain, of grab the land, of grab the gold, of grab the ways of satisfying need, of work the men, of take the pay, of owning everything for one's own greed. I am the farmer, bondsman to the soil. I am the worker sold to the machine. I am the Negro, servant to you all. I am the people, humble, hungry, mean, hungry, yet today, despite the dream, beaten, yet today, O pioneer. I am the man who never got ahead, the poorest worker bartered through the years. Yet I'm the one who dreamt our basic dream in the old world while still a serf of kings, who dreamt a dream so strong, so brave, so true, that even yet its mighty daring sings in every brick and stone, in every furrow turned, that's made America the land it has become. Oh, I'm the man who sailed those early seas in search of what I meant to be my home. For I'm the one who left dark Ireland's shore and Poland's plain and England's grassy lea, and torn from black Africa's strand, I came to build a homeland of the free. The free? Who said the free? Not me. Surely not me. The millions on relief today. The millions shot down when we strike. The millions who have nothing for our pay. For all the dreams we've dreamed, and all the songs we've sung, and all the hopes we've held, and all the flags we've hung. The millions who have nothing for our pay, except the dream that's almost dead today. Oh, let America be America again, the land that never has been yet, and yet must be. The land where every man is free. The land that's mine, the poor man's, Indians, Negroes, me. Who made America, whose sweat and blood, whose faith and pain, whose hand at the foundry, whose plow in the rain must bring back our mighty dream again. Sure, call me any ugly name you choose. The steel of freedom does not stain from those who live like leeches on the people's lives. We must take back our land again, America. Oh yes, I say it plain. America never was America to me. And yet I swear this oath, America will be out of the rack and ruin of our gangster death, the rape and rot of graft, stealth and lies. We the people must redeem the land, the mines, the plants, the rivers, the mountains and the endless plain. All the stretch of these great green states, and make America again.
For those who would like, I invite you to join me in speaking aloud our congregational covenant. We, the members and friends of the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Montgomery, promise to serve our community with open minds, willing hearts, and helping hands as we respect one another, honoring that our perceptions may differ, value our differences, working to better understand them in conflict, give joyfully of ourselves, being in harmony with our capabilities, and embrace our connections with each other, nature, the global community, and the great mystery of life. And now let's hear from our coordinator of religious education, Roger Burdett with A Time for All Ages. As he finishes up the book that he's been sharing with us these last several weeks.
Hey, welcome to Show and Tell. I know, that's not what I normally say, but really, this is Show and Tell. We have a museum in this town, which, by the way, is related to the story I'm finishing up today. The museum is called the Legacy Museum. It's an Equal Justice Initiative museum. If you've never been, or even if you have, you should go. They cover civil rights issues from slavery all the way through mass incarceration. Mass incarceration comes up today, which is why I went there. Bought this shirt, Do Justice, Love Mercy. But wait, there's more. I bought some books. I read to my high school students. I do. I've done it for years and I love it. This book is written by an author from Saudi Arabia, and it deals with some issues dealing with gender in Saudi Arabia. I was there in the Air Force. I noticed gender issues, but I bought this book, A Girl Like That. It's a young adult novel. I bought this one, Color Me In. It's about a biracial girl whose mother or father, one of her parents is African American and the other parent is Jewish. So this story is about this young lady working through those issues. But I also got a couple of books for us. At some point, I will read this, The Other Side. An unforgettable story of the power of friendship, written by Jacqueline Woodson. And finally, All Because You Matter. Got all that at the Legacy Museum today. But this is why we're here. Welcome to Time for All Ages. So I think this is the fifth week, and I'm going to really zip through it this week and finish this story up. It's called The Ellises and the Time Machine. Why do we have to say Black Lives Matter? Written by DeVal Ellis, illustrated by H.H. Pax, published by McBride Stories. So the story revolves around a young boy named Jackson. He and his father were watching a basketball game. They made a big deal out of Black Lives Matter. Jackson says, "Hey, Pop, why do we even have to say Black Lives Matter?" Pop happens to have a time machine. So they travel back 400 years. We have looked at history in this book. We have considered chattel slavery, the Vagrancy Act, Black codes, Jim Crow, Ku Klux Klan, convict leasing, the Tulsa Race Massacre, redlining. Today we're going to zip through. I will use our own time machine to zip through the last bit of this book. Not because the last bits are not just as important as everything else, but I just want to wrap up the book, get to the conclusion, and move on to something different next time. So the book covers police brutality. In 1954, during the Civil Rights Movement, Black Americans began experiencing extreme physical violence at the hands of the local police. Then they touch on the Black Panther Party, started by a couple of college students. The War on Drugs in 1971, just a few years after the end of segregation and gaining the right to vote, President Nixon announced the War on Drugs. The book asserts that the War on Drugs was meant to target Black Americans and leaders by disrupting and over-policing their communities. And then the book gets to mass incarceration. Although slavery ended 131 years earlier and segregation 29 years prior, many Black people struggled to thrive after the Civil Rights Movement because of redlining, which we've gone over, police brutality, and federal legislations that continue to target and terrorize Black communities. In 1994, the largest crime bill in the history of the United States was passed, the Violent Crime Control and Law Enforcement Act. This bill created a surge in the number of arrests of black men and women. They were given harsher sentences, while private companies began profiting from the prison industrial complex. And then the book covers the Black Lives Matter movement, which started in 2013 after the state of Florida failed to convict the murderer of an unarmed 17-year-old black boy, Trayvon Martin. And that gets us to the conclusion of the story. After visiting 400 years of history, Kadeen, the wife, speaks up and says, "Hey, babe, I think it's time we head back." So, Babe, also known as the father, also known as DeVal, says, "Okay, Ellis, it's time to go back." So they put on their glasses. DeVal hit the red button. A huge white flash appeared, and the Ellises were home instantly. Now, is that the end of the story? Or do people do some processing after learning history? Remember that the central question in this book is, why do we have to say Black Lives Matter? Why do we have to say that? Now back in Jackson's room, after a journey that covered over 400 years, DeVal said, "So you see, we say Black Lives Matter to remind America that they forgot about us when they said, with liberty and justice for all. So all we're asking for is equality, right, Pops?" asked Jackson. "Yeah, bruh, it's crazy that we still have to ask for it," says DeVal. So Jackson runs to open up his closet. "Hey, where you going?" says Kadeen. That's the mother. "The history lesson's over. You don't want to finish watching the game with your dad?" "Are you kidding me?" says Jackson. "We need to change, and I can't change anything watching a game. We need action," says Jackson. "Yeah," says Cairo. "Yeah," says Kaz, speaking for the first time. That's apparently the youngest of the siblings. "Yeah." Jackson pushed his mom and dad out of the room and closed the door, and now mom and dad are second-guessing themselves. They really covered some pretty intense history, right? "Do you think I shared too much?" asked DeVal. "No," says Kadeen, "not at all. If they're anything like you, they're going to work together to change the world for the better," says Kadeen, and she gave DeVal a warm hug. Meanwhile, back in the bedroom, where the younger children are, aka the younger generation, "We got work to do, gentlemen," said Jackson. "Yeah," screamed Cairo and Kaz in unison. And that is where this story ends. Black lives matter because people, all people, are created equal. I learned a lot. I appreciate this story. I appreciated the context. Go forth, do justice, love, mercy, and have a really, really great week.
We take a time out in each service to lift up and let go the things that we've been carrying with us through the week. These have been some complicated, busy, confusing, frustrating times. We rejoice in the recognition at last of the Day of Liberation, Juneteenth. And still we remain frustrated as our nation's government seems stuck in so many ways, in its refusal to investigate a violent insurrection, in its fear of facing and confronting and dealing with the unpleasant realities of our political landscape. I invite you to use the chat adjacent to the video screen to speak the things that are on your heart this morning so that we may know each other's hearts and be together in this fellowship. Our practice to share the undesignated Sunday offering with an organization doing work on the ground to which we are dedicated in principle, and for this quarter we have selected King's Canvas for the important ministry on the west side of Montgomery, and we welcome and are grateful for this opportunity to participate in reaching out and helping individuals whom we may never meet, but whose lives are important to us.
If you hear this message, wherever you stand, I'm calling every woman, calling every man. We're the generation, we can't afford to wait. The future started yesterday, and we're already late. We've been looking for a song to sing, search for a melody, search for someone to lead. We've been looking for the world to change. If you feel the same, then go on and say, if you're out there, sing along with me. If you're out there, I'm dying to believe that you're out. Stand up and say it loud if you're out there. Tomorrow's starting now. No more broken promises, no more call to war. Unless it's love and peace that we're really fighting for. Destroy hunger, we can conquer hate. Put down the arms and raise your voice. We're joining hands today.
I was looking for a song to sing.
Search for a leader, but the leader was me.
We were looking for the world to change.
We can be heroes.
Believe that.
message wherever you stand. I'm calling every woman, calling every man. We're the generation we can't afford to wait. The future started yesterday, and we're already late.
I'm going to talk a little about critical race theory today, because this deliberate misinformation and willful ignorance about critical race theory is the context to which I speak today. Now, that might make you think that this is a sermon about race. I assure you, this is not a sermon about race, except in the way that everything is about race. My topic today is salvation. Bet you didn't see that coming. My title comes from the words of Jesus of Nazareth reported in the Christian scripture in the Gospel according to John. I want to be clear about that text. The Gospel of John is quite different from any other work in the library that makes up Christian scripture. In the Gospel of John, Jesus has quite a different character from any of the other accounts of his life that we find in the scripture. For example, everywhere else he teaches almost exclusively in parables, and there is not a single parable in the Gospel of John. There is no account of his origin story. John was written in Greek for a Hellenic audience, and they engaged with knowledge and history and philosophy in a substantially different way from the Roman culture and the Jews who lived under the Roman Empire. John is the only text that depicts Jesus as a divine figure. And the words are almost never intended to mean what they seem, and they're almost always taken out of context. I suspect in large part that's because the Greek emphasis on rhetoric gives us some memorable and beautiful phrases throughout. The claim that the truth will set you free is just one example. And the notion that the truth will set you free appears to be true on its face, but it's fraught with all sorts of implications and connotations. You know, it's a trope in pop psychology and self-help to say that you hold the key to unlock your own prison. And in most cases, of course, it's mainly true. But in most cases, we need help to find and to use that key. Chemical dependency and addiction, abusive religious ideology, living with trauma, abusive relationships, whatever builds that invisible prison, liberation begins with facing the truth, the full reality of the circumstances that broke us. And this is a thing that Europe understood following World War II. And they faced the horrors of the Nazi regime head on. Many German citizens were blissfully ignorant of the genocide carried out by its own government in the internment camps that had previously been known as places for holding communists and anarchists and other enemies of the state. Knowing and acknowledging the starvation, slave labor, torture, and mass murder that had been perpetrated in their name, for their benefit, and with their tacit consent was necessary in order to move forward. Following the fall of the apartheid regime in South Africa, the nation struggled to face and acknowledge the horrors committed by the state with at least tacit consent of those who benefited from preferential treatment, not for merit or for their good deeds, but because of their white skin. Those who had actively participated in atrocities were held to account and expected to testify as to the specific crimes against humanity. It didn't bring about peace and love all around in South Africa, and there's a long way to go in establishing true cooperation and trust. But the Truth and Reconciliation Commission was a necessary, if not sufficient, precondition to any hope of peace. In this country, in the aftermath of 2.5 centuries of chattel slavery that dehumanized, tortured, and murdered human beings in numbers that may never be fully known, we took a noticeably different approach. Abraham Lincoln was desperate to restore a sense of national unity and an end to the violence and death. With that in mind, he declined to prosecute any of the treasonous combatants who waged war against the U.S. government. And that decision largely sets the stage for the nation's response to all of the atrocities that the South's war effort sought to perpetuate. It gave room for Andrew Johnson as president to encourage and facilitate oppression, forced labor, and murder of Black people for generations afterward. Yes, it's true, those atrocities were race-based. But this isn't about race, except in the way that everything is about race. This is about our nation's steadfast, deliberate refusal to face up to its own behaviors. A refusal that keeps us locked in a prison of ignorance and hostility. Through the years, artistic and academic movements have arisen to call attention to and invite a reckoning with the actions that the dominant culture fights so hard to keep silent. Artistic movements like the Harlem Renaissance, which brings us Langston Hughes, and academic movements like critical race theory, which brings me to this day. Most of you have heard the outcry, no doubt, coming from the far right and in conservative-controlled state legislatures. Everything they see wrong with this country now can be linked back to critical race theory. Of course, the target of those diatribes is rarely, if ever, actually critical race theory. But more often, just the trend in arts and education to pay attention to and honor the presence of non-white people in this country and throughout our history. White privilege, unconscious bias, white supremacy culture, those ideas don't arise from critical race theory. Black Lives Matter, the movement for Black lives, anti-racism, working to ensure voting rights for historically marginalized people, including Black people, none of that comes out of critical race theory. Culturally sensitive, culturally responsive education is not critical race theory. Nothing that exists in the curriculum of K through 12 education is even remotely critical race theory. Critical race theory is a school of thought in legal studies. It's a branch of critical legal studies, CLS. There are comparable branches dealing with queer folk, immigrant populations, people with disabilities, and more. Critical race theory suggests that in laws and legal procedures that appear on the surface to be race neutral, there are benefits and hindrances applied for white and black people, respectively. Nobody's teaching that in grade school. Maybe that's too bad, but it's true. And it's always been true. Critical race theory is not the boogeyman. What they're afraid of, what some in conservative circles are reacting to, is a cultural shift towards equity. It's the flexing of the arc and the balancing of the numbers. And you know, I know you hear it too. Much is always made of justice movements being divisive. Neither critical race theory nor the cultural shifts that are actually the target of these reactionary forces is divisive. They bring long-standing division into view for those of us who have had the luxury our entire lives to not see it. Calling a thing divisive is a false flag, a red herring, to encourage and bolster resistance to progress. When participants in the Me Too movement or victims of sexual abuse at Ohio State or University of Michigan come forward and create disruption in those systems, they're not the problem, they're the solution. When attorneys and legal nonprofits raise the issue of wrongful convictions and even wrongful executions, they are the solution, even though prosecutors and law enforcement see them as divisive. When freedom riders decades ago, or Poor People's Campaign today, break the law in acts of civil disobedience in order to call attention to injustice, it may have the effect of division, of bringing conflict to the surface. But that's kind of the whole point. It's the disruption, the airing of conflict necessary to begin moving toward resolution, reconciliation, and justice. If we could, as a people, as a nation, face the reality described by critical race theory, we just might find a key. The key to unlock a prison of injustice, inequity, and inequality that has existed from our earliest beginnings and continues today. Dr. King tried to tell us how white people also suffer from racial inequality, that the struggle for justice isn't just about getting stuff for black people, it's about healing the soul of our sick nation. It's about establishing beloved community that could offer peace and wellness to all of its citizens. This is not about race, except in the way that everything is about race. And yes, everything is about race. It's just that we who have racial advantage in the equation don't have to know that. Just like if you are fully able-bodied, you don't know that everything is about physical disability. Where you live, what you do for a living, whether or not you can go to the theater or eat in a particular restaurant. It's all about your physical ability. But if you do not live with disability, you may never know that. Likewise, where it is safe to live and how much you pay for it, whether you have a career of your choosing and how well you fare in it, whether you call the police when you are assaulted, all of that may be determined by whether you are trans or cisgender. Everything in life is about things that the dominant or privileged group in a given category never has to recognize. In this way, whether you have been able to live your entire life without knowing it or not, everything is about race. So the next time you observe that a particular thing isn't about race, I encourage you to add that phrase, except in the way that everything is about race. Even if you aren't sure you believe it, the more you call it to your own attention, the more you will begin to understand it. But truly, this sermon is not about race, except in the way that everything is about race. It is about the fierce determination of a dominant group in our society to deny and decry every effort to tell the truth about ourselves and find hope for reconciliation. It is about that hope. Hope that is actually an aspect of critical race theory. Critical race theory holds that we can rectify the corruptions and distortions in our system if we acknowledge them and face them. Critical race theory tells us not only that we have constructed barriers and obstacles in our system, both intentionally and unwittingly, that give advantage to white people, it also tells us that this is not inevitable and the structure is not impermeable. We have held the key all along. Liberation is possible. And salvation is at hand for this nation, if we will choose it.
Reaching to be free.
come over to Zoom for second hour. It's going to be a little different. It's going to be a little more business than usual because in this irregular, unpredictable world that we have been living in for the past almost year and a half now, it has been very difficult to prepare for our annual meeting. And one of the things we really need to do to prepare for our annual meeting is talk about the budget. The members of the congregation have all the authority to establish the budget. Fortunately, our treasurer has done the hard work of crafting a draft budget. But I want you to know what's in it and why before you vote on it. Next week, we're going to vote on it. I need you to come next week if you're a member because we need a quorum. But I would very much like you to come today to talk about, to hear about, to speak about the way in which the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Montgomery allocates its funds, the funds that you have contributed as part of your participation in this body. Next week, beginning on Wednesday, I, Ruth, Felicia, and Courtney will be in General Assembly online. Keep an eye on your email. Stay checking in to Facebook if you're on there. And please come over to second hour. For now, our service has ended. May our service begin.
good.